Okay, wonderful. So we have Vedic Panda, everyone. Let's give our players a quick introduction. From the United States, Jed Sloan, Magnus can meet. Jed.
I'll just start down.
We can go ahead. Jed to the left on board number two. Isaac from Canada. Isaac Wiebe. At board number four, Polina Carolina, representing the Bahamas. Soren Merks from Germany. And as you guys will all notice on the high screens, Magnus, as is customary in simuls, and many grandmasters will do this, they will try to alternate their opening moves so as to, you know, not, I guess, replicate strategies so close in proximity so that player can not take
advantage. We're minutes away from starting. Which one is the most challenging player, Ludwig? Do you know that?
Well, actually, we can see that Magnus has made his first move on actually plenty of boards right now. It's the last one of the 11 boards. We are set to go. And the strongest player, according to the ratings, is Mr. Gustav Gulbansen from Norway. So it will be interesting to see his game.
He's a 52-year-old from Norway?
Yeah, and he's sitting on board number six. But I think the important part to take in the beginning, there's going to be a lot of moves, quick moves, and I want to stress what Magnus was saying at the very beginning in his interview here with Jonathan. And that is that he's just going to try to play very fast. And it's important for him to get not only a good start, but a quick start. He needs to make sure he doesn't start lagging behind on time on every single board.
Is a quick start better than a good start?
No. I mean, there's a balance. You want to get the games done as soon as possible. But these are good players, so it's not going to be that easy. You might as well just try to play fast and get the game progressing, get as many moves in as little time as you.
And how quickly does he size up which games he particularly has to concentrate on and worry about?
I really don't know. I think the opening will decide that. So after we have a couple of moves on the board, he will probably make some mental note of this is going to be a tricky game. I'll have to spend some extra seconds here, but that's all he has, some extra seconds.
Right.
And then the other boards, he's just going to try to finish it as fast as possible. I noticed that Jonathan was asking Magnus, do you aim to simplify as soon as possible? And that could be a good strategy in terms of it being easier to find the good moves, but it could also lead to a longer game. And a longer game means more time spent.
I also assume, particularly against the stronger players, but against all of them, that he's going to vary from sort of the received best move in that position so he doesn't have opponents that have just, you know, booked up on a major line.
Yeah, but for instance here, we see him moving, actually, I think, quite slowly. He's moving calmly and...
Right.
I don't know. 30 minutes? It's not that much time. So it's going to be very interesting to see how the time situation is in 15 minutes.
Does he have to speed up now?
No, probably not at this moment, but he's very relaxed. So I'm not sure that the time could be an issue for sure.
Okay, let's have a look at some of the tables. Does it have a difficult way to
We can start out with table six, which is the highest rated player, Gustav Gudbansen from Norway.
Yeah.
And we can see that Magnus is playing against a French defense, and he's trying just to get his pieces out in good positions. Yeah, it's way too early to say anything definitive, but it does seem like in this game, Magnus will have a position that's easy to play.
That exists and people have seen before. this particular position.
Yeah, for sure. But now. But that's not really what matters.
Of course.
I mean, what matters is that Magnus will know what to do the second he gets to the board. So in terms of where the players, if they can get Magnus to use time, that would be fantastic. Not only for themselves, but also for the other players. So if we can try to see if there's some tricky position here, I would maybe go to board number one and the player Vedic Panda from the USA. And I think this is more of a position that could be tricky for Magnus to find some good moves.
When Chris and Fabiana were playing in the...
So now, every single time Magnus is walking around, he's doing his moves pretty quickly. But as long as his clock is running on 5, 6, 7 different boards at the same time, that's going to make the challenge for him. It's actually... It's bad if the players make their moves immediately after he makes his, because then he can just stay there and blitz the moves and get the game finished sooner. But it's also not good if Magnus is spending time on other boards.
And now we got a situation like that. He was moving when Magnus was turning his back.
Yeah, and that is, to be frank, the clever strategy.
Move as soon as he... leave your board. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, not when he leaves, but maybe when he's
when
two
he's turning around.
Right.
Two boards away, then it's going to be a long walk back for Magnus, and you can maybe pressure him on time.
Yeah. And the player on the right side is maximizing his time now, I think.
So let's take a look at game one again with Panda. And it's a really interesting pawn lounge with this g5 move, really trying to complicate matters. And I think that's an interesting strategy, really trying to play an orthodox chess and thereby making Magnus have to think about his moves more.
So I think there's a couple other boards where we have fairly strong players, like expert category players on boards 3 and 8.
Yeah, so we can look at board 3, which is Isaac Wiebe. And this is a Dutch defense in which Magnus has gotten all his pieces out. So it's an unusual, slightly unusual opening, but Magnus just has gotten his pieces in a good position. So I would say the main thing here is still looking at the time. We want to see which player who can pressure Magnus the most on the clock, which makes it a good idea to look at the board in which Magnus has the least amount of time right now. And actually, that is the game with Vedic Panda. I mean, we've been talking about this game for a little bit, but the strategy of the American player has been pretty good. He has lost a pawn, but he has an orthodox position, and he has made Magnus think.
And he's only 15 years old, born in 2001.
Nice. So on board 8 is another expert player where Magnus has advanced his h-pawn.
Yeah.
That's an interesting game.
So if we look at the board 8, we see Magnus really aggressively trying to bring his rook into play. Normally you do this by castling, getting the rook into the center. And instead here, Magnus sees the opportunity that the black king has castled. My rook is on the same line or adjacent to the black king. Let's try just to open up next to the black king, get that white rook into play without ever having to move it, just pushing that pawn and getting rid of the pawn, basically, to start an attack.
As we all know, these boards, the king doesn't want to get castled relatively early.
There are also some games in which Magnus really has tremendous control already. So we might want to mention that as well. We can look at the other Norwegian, Emil Hartvedt, in which Magnus has won a piece. So that's a very bad start for Emil, but it's also a very bad start for the other competitors, because every time Magnus gets a board out of play, the chances of the other players drop. So what Emil can do now, for the best of the whole group, really, is just try to survive for as long as possible, keep having Magnus having to spend time on making moves there, having some vague chances of winning on time. That's going to be an important strategy. We can also mention that there's something. I mean, we have one board which just doesn't have any moves. And I'm wondering, what board is that? Is that a relay error? Or are we actually lacking one player?
On board 10.
It's Andrew, isn't it?
No, but I mean, I count 11 players down on the down there. So probably it's just a relay error, which is good. Simply because 11 and 10 players, it really makes a huge difference. And the play, they just need to do as well as they can for as long as they can in order to keep Magnus occupied with making moves everywhere.
So on actually on board 2, we had a substitute player, a gentleman, very young man, as you can see, Jed Sloan, who was filling in for Moshe on board 2, also from the United States.
Okay. How old is he?
That's a good question. I think 6 or 7, but I'm not sure.
Okay.
And we see Magnus is really turning the screws on Emil. He's in huge trouble, and he's now about to lose his queen to knight takes e7 check. So I think Magnus is about to wrap up his first game, and that's a big success, and it's really going to make it so much more difficult for the rest of the participants. But
and Emil says to us that he tried to don't get a fool on himself in just a few minutes.
Yeah, so I think let's do a little wrap-up of the boards in which Magnus has the least time. And so there's one board that is just Magnus has 20 minutes left on the clock, and the second the board in which Magnus has the second least time is 22 minutes. So we really have to commend Vedic Panda on board 1 once again, because he's really getting Magnus to think, and it's clear that his creative style has given Magnus some initial problems. However, looking at the position, we can see that Magnus has given back a pawn in order to get some good exchanges. And we can see that the black bishop, the bishop on light squares, is in big, big trouble because it's being blocked by the black pawns. So Magnus has traded the pawn he was up, and he has traded in for a positional advantage instead. Yeah,
I think we saw Emil and Magnus shook hands now.
Yeah, I believe Magnus has won his first game of this simul against Emil Hartvedt.
He should have hung on a bit just to try to make Magnus move at his board.
Well, as we can see on the if we take up the board,
he's not going to be able to hang on that much longer because get mated.
Emil had lost his queen, so that was unfortunate, but he really should have played on, because even if Magnus is completely winning, you really just need to try to get him to spend those 2 extra seconds at the board, because the 2 extra seconds multiply with the other participants.
Sure.
So let's see if there are any other interesting boards. I think we should go to board number 9. Which is the Spanish girl, Yvette Salada Samara, and in which Magnus has played a very aggressive knight check, forking the king and queen. That is solved by her move, taking out Magnus's knight. But this has opened up for the white queen to go into an attacking position, taking Black's knight on h6, and then I think it's a massive attack for Magnus.
That looks like it will all be over very quickly.
Yeah, it looks like Magnus is going to checkmate with a nice sacrifice and then decisive attack. The queen and Magnus's knight combining brilliantly to try to give checkmate there.
But where does Magnus struggling?
That is the problem. We really cannot see any board in which Magnus is in trouble. It really looks like he's got this completely under control. Maybe let's try to go to board 11 and Ben Berkowitz. Because here we can see that at the very least the pieces, the material is equal. And also, Magnus has not castled his king yet, and as any fourth grader will tell you, at least as every scholastic chess player will tell you,
as every chess host will tell you,
precisely, that is not good. So Magnus is aiming that he advances his. If we can take up the board, we can see that Magnus plans to. Keep a central majority. His pawns are very well poised in the middle of the board. And then he says, I can delay castling as long as I will do it later on.
And Black will have to move his knight any moment.
Yeah,
as soon as there's
let's
not a
try
pin
to get
there.
That yeah. board on the screen. Because now we see that Magnus was late castling, but he just did it. So his king is safe and he can count on an opening advantage. If we can get the board up on screen.
If any of you are familiar with that position, just imagine that would work.
Let's look for Ben's board. Here it is.
Yeah, so Magnus got his king into safety a bit late, but when you are the world champion, you are allowed to make some exceptions to the early castling rule of thumb. Let's see if there are any other interesting positions. Maybe we will once again move back to Michael Dimitriadis. Because here we have Magnus really going caveman style, pushing up his h-pawn, getting that file open for the rook, which is now really threatening towards the black king.
I think he must have visited Washington Square Park and some of the places here in the New York area where caveman style goes on all the boards.
Yeah,
sometimes it works.
Yeah, no, aggressive. It's an aggressive attitude. And I'm not sure it's going to work out here. I think it's been very... Michael has been very good in keeping calm. It's not clear how Magnus can get his queen over from the queen side, the left-hand side of the board, to the king side. So if we can have that board, if we can have the board up on screen, we can see that White's queen really cannot get over to the king side, attacking the black king without. Without being exchanged off. So the immediate idea would be to go with the queen all the way over, eight squares across, but then it would be exchanged off by the black queen. So for the moment, I think Michael can be happy with his position.
Very good.
And we also have another decided game, and that is... The Yvette was brutally attacked by this duo, the white queen and knight, and we see there's really nothing she could do from the position we had the last time, and the knight and queen just cooperated brilliantly
made on
to
the
give
board,
checkmate.
Yeah.
There was really nothing she could do to prevent this plan from Magnus.
So which opponent now do you think is doing the best? Not in terms of time, but the actual position.
I'm going to have to say the game we were just looking at. I think, although it looks dangerous with this open file, I think Michael Dimitriadis has the best position.
I think the queens are off now.
Yeah, so Magnus decided, let's go back and watch that game again. Magnus did decide to go with his queen, but his attack... is now averted, with the queens being exchanged off. So we've been talking a lot about time, and that time is the best way that these players can pressure Magnus. And if we look at the board in which Magnus has the least amount of time now, it's still on board one with Verdic Panda. That is good. But the problem is that his king is in a vulnerable position. Magnus really has an attack going with the queen pointing towards the black king, and now also the white rook pointing down the file. So I think this looks dangerous for him.
And as where my worst fears is.
Yeah. No, I think
so. In that in game one, what do you think Black should try to do?
I think Black is just in huge trouble.
Can you bring the Queen's Rook to help with? Yeah, he
yeah,
did actually.
Precisely what he did. Very good. The Rook is trying to force the White Queen off its beautiful central square, and what Magnus is going to do is he's just going to move his pawn two squares up, in order to block this attack, keep the queen centrally placed, and keep Black thinking, what am I going to do with my king? What am I going to do with this white queen attacking my king?
What do you think Magnus is going to do against Panda now?
I
oh,
thought
he
was going
to... queen. Interesting.
Yeah.
I thought he might have interposed. Yeah.
I really thought he would go in between with his pawn. We can see that instead he's aiming just to try to take out the black pawn on b5. Both strategies are probably good. And just look at the two black pieces in the corner. They are really not contributing in the game. And that's going to be... Well, trapped is a bit strong, but they are not contributing. And that means that their value is not as good as what we usually think a rook is worth. It's just, yeah, well, trapped maybe in the corner. Doesn't get out.
Okay, he's chasing the queen to giving up his...
He's chasing the queen, but then he's losing a pawn and he's still behind in development. So
absolutely.
I think Magnus has a very good position here. One player we have not been talking about is Polina Kahelina on board four. And she has an interesting pawn structure. This is called the Benoni structure. And it looked to me like a decent version for Black until I realized there's a pawn missing. Black is actually a pawn down. Normally you have an F pawn to try to break up White's control over the center. But right now, Black is in trouble. Because the white pawns beautifully aligned in this row, protecting each other, are just forming a very solid solid structure, really full control over the middle of the board, and that's going to force Polina on the defensive. So, yeah, maybe let's move to Gustav Gudbrandsen, the 2200-rated player, who is the highest-rated player in the field. But that is not necessarily going to help you when playing the world champion. So what has happened is that this isolated pawn, this pawn that is difficult to protect because you cannot have pawns guarding it, he actually just lost that pawn. Magnus' last move, queen takes d5, got rid of that pawn, trying to exchange off more pieces, going into an endgame, and just being a pawn up in an endgame. I actually played Magnus once and lost in an endgame. Somebody commented to me, oh, Magnus, he's so good at endgames, aren't he? isn't he? And I just responded, well, I mean, it's just that he keeps being a pawn up in all these endgames.
then they're easy to play.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah. I mean, it's much easier to win endgames when you're a pawn up all the time. But of course, the reason he's pawn up is that he's played a good strategic game. So Gudbjørnsen is trying to do a counterattack, pushing down towards the pawn on f2. We should talk a bit about the graphics we have on screen. Because this is a computer analysis of the chances right now. And as we can see, the computer is heavily favoring Magnus on every single board. And the game in which the computer thinks Magnus's opponents have the best chances is board 8 and board 11. So I think let's move to board 11. Which is Ben Berkowitz. And I cannot
understand. The computer might think that, but that kind of looks kind of nasty with those pawns shoved down your throat. I would not.
Yeah, this looks not too good for black, partially because of the white pawns, but also white is just a piece up.
That too.
So this is not looking good for Ben, and I think he's in huge trouble. So let's move to Michael, which I still think he has by far the best position of all the players. Magnus's rook is very awkwardly placed on c4. He will try to justify it. He will try to say, okay, it's unusual to have a rook placed like this, but I can make it work. I have the bishop pointing down the diagonal from g2 towards the black queen side, and he will also try to move his rook into the open file here on b1 and point down the file. So that is going to be Magnus's plan. Michael will do his very best to defend, and he could really use some help from the other participants. Try to get them to occupy Magnus's time, get them to get Magnus thinking, and then we might be able to see him pulling off an upset here.
So our substitute player, Jed Sloan, on board 2, he turns out to have just turned 8 years old. I checked on that. And how is he doing?
Yeah, let's look at our 8-year-old substitute. He's been doing okay, but at the moment it's the white pawns that are looking just menacing. They are really, it's perfect whenever pawns are protecting themselves, getting a row like this with every single pawn protecting
each other. And down two pawns also.
Down two pawns, the white king is going to come up. I think it's going to be a victory for the world champion, but he might survive for a long time. The best he could do right now is try to hang on for as long as he can to help the other participants. Right now, there's a scary threat of the knight going to f6, forking the king and the rook. So he will have to try to do something about that in the near future. Let's actually move to Gustav Gudbjørnsen, the Norwegian on board 6. And he managed to get his pawn back, but at a cost. Because right now, Magnus is threatening the black bishop. And that bishop really has a limited amount of squares to go to, because it's doing a very important job of protecting the black knight deep inside white's territory. And basically what's going to happen is that black is losing a piece. His knight went into danger and tried to say that, okay, I can get my pawn back, let's try to get that and then escape back out. But what Magnus has done, he has calculated the variations accurately, and he managed to force the black bishop away from the defense of the black knight, and that's going to win him a piece.
Right, it can be taken on any square that it goes to try to defend the knight.
Yeah. So if the bishop keeps going, staying on this diagonal, for instance, going back, it's just going to be taken by the white knight, and then the knight on f2 is going to be lost.
Do you think Magnus is going to make all the boards? Mm-hmm. Going to win all the boards?
It's certainly looking like that. I think the only player who's putting up a fantastic fight is Michael Dimitriadis. And I think he's really just saying to the other players, keep on trying, keep on, never resign.
Because
make
I need
him
the
keep
time.
Thinking.
Now, he has a time disadvantage, which is not so great to have against the world champion to be 8 minutes down on the clock.
Yeah, so his advantage is that right now there are many other players that Magnus has to think about as well.
Right.
But if it goes down to a situation in which he's one-on-one against Magnus with less time, that's going to be tricky.
Last year I played Magnus. He played three players at once. He was blindfolded. It was clocked, and I did fine until it was down to the two of us, and then he quickly disposed of me. So you want to avoid that.
So one player we haven't talked about is Isaac Wiebe on board three. And he is relatively equal on material. He's a pawn down. But the real difference here is how good Magnus's knight is. This knight on e4 is just a monster, controlling every side of the board. And he's looking like Magnus slowly but surely will try to find some way of getting this extra pawn he has on b3, trying to get that to get a new queen. That will be his objective. But I really think that Isaac can do a good job here of making Magnus use time, trying to convert that extra pawn.
How would you describe the control Magnus has on this stunt?
I think Magnus has just, it just feels like he's been in complete control the whole time. It's difficult to say what.
Now there's a fork on board one. He's forked the queen and rook.
Yeah, so let's move to board one. A fork on the queen and on the rook, but you can give a check in order to save the queen. Moving the queen to c5 will save the black rook, but it will not save the black knight, which is attacked on the f-file with the white rook. So I think let's go to Michael Dimitriadis on board 8 and see how he's doing with his very unorthodox, I have to say, position against the world champion. He just played b4, and really what has happened, which I'm not a big fan of, is that this rook on c5, it's now on a square that cannot be attacked by any black pawns. And that's also always a fantastic place to get one of your pieces. Whenever your opponent cannot push you away with a pawn, it means your positioning there is reasonably safe. And this rook, which was, it was awkward, it was a bit unusual earlier, it has now really found a fantastic placement to create pressure against the black position.
Pretty happy with how you played? I was expecting to be the last player, the first player being by Magnus Carlsen. I was expecting to lose on move 17, to be honest.
I didn't expect this.
You know, a real fighter here, a real fighter, Jed.
Fantastic 8-year-old.
That was our substitute 8-year-old who had to resign against the world champion, but it's an experience for a lifetime.
Yeah.
Stay right here. Aren't you going to be able to do a post-mortem, as I said? Magnus, with his eidetic memory,
needs no paper or book or even computer to go back over every single one of these games and each variation. I, in speaking with Magnus, have realized that
We haven't actually caught all the results, so let's maybe do a wrap-up on that. Magnus has already won 3 games, is that correct? Or is he up more than that?
The players who played the game. So, obviously, his own games that he just played 2 minutes ago would be like child's play for him, so... You guys will be able to see something very, very...
So Magnus is really in control here on basically every single board.
Ben, how are you feeling with
for an average guy, it seems like brain magic. This is incredible.
Yeah, nothing to be nervous about. Magnus is extremely...
so let's see, which game is... You did a fantastic which opponent job. Is now giving him any trouble at all, let's see.
Yeah, I'm still gonna put I'm still gonna highlight Dimitriadis. I think his position has deteriorated the last couple of moves, but he does have the same amount of pawns. It's equal material, and at this moment, that's a success in itself.
Sure.
One player we haven't talked about is Søren Marks on board 5. And this is actually quite a complicated position as far as I could tell. But now it seems that the complications are not working out in Søren's favor. He's also very, very low on time. He only has 2 minutes left. There's no additional time for either Magnus nor the participants.
And then the computer doesn't leave him a chance.
No, because right now Magnus is about to capture this bishop on e7, and that's going to be a piece down, as well as a big time disadvantage. That's not going to work out very well against the world chess champion.
6 board left for Magnus Carlsen.
A fast player, which I believe Søren is not going to pay him homage in that
So we still have material even on board 8, even though Magnus's rook has that great square.
Yeah, no, this is just playing against an opponent which has such a magnificently placed piece. It's really, really irritating because you think, okay, I need to get this piece away in one way or another. But it's just so difficult to force him back. You don't have any pawns who can push him back. And when you don't have that, how do you get it away? So right now
The e-pawn is attacked.
Yeah, right now the pawn on e4 is under attack. So presumably the right move is using your pawn so that they defend themselves on e4, f5, and g6. But after that, how do you get the white rook, this rook on c5, how do you exchange it off? How do you push it off the board? Because right now, it's just such a nuisance. You really need to get that exchanged off as soon as possible.
Does Magnus get tired when he do things like this?
I would think so. I can say from my own experience that I may not be as fit as Magnus, because every time I do a simul like this, I actually get a bit of back pain after just walking around all the time
and
leaning over the tables.
Okay.
No, not a headache.
Okay.
So yeah, I mean, it's going to be a bit of a physical challenge. I was very surprised how calm he was in the beginning, how reasonably slowly he was moving. So clearly, Magnus is thinking that it's so important to get the good moves at the beginning.
Control everything.
In order to keep things under control. and never having any position in which he has to like sit down and spend 15, 30 seconds to think. Because if you do that, it's going to affect every single game you're playing.
I think board 8 is very interesting, the move that Magnus just made, d3.
Yeah, it's a board we still have on here with Michael Dimitriadis. And this d3 move is really highlighting how annoying this rook on c5 is, because if you were to take the pawn on d3, there's a bishop on g2 ready to capture the knight on c6, so that's not going to be possible. We see Michael doing what we said, trying to get this rook off at the earliest possible moment, but in this exchange, Magnus is going to say, okay, you get my rook, but I'm going to get your pawn. And then, actually, I think Magnus is going to try to use this square once again, but maybe just get another piece there. So that's a pawn up for Magnus on board 8. Let's move to... Which board should we move to?
Now Magnus has stopped. This is the first time he has stopped at the board.
Yeah, so we should move to Gustav Gudbjørnsen, who at the very least got Magnus thinking for a little bit. Magnus, with his knight to h6, is attacking both the black king and the black pawn. Black moving his king up, attacking the knight, but right now, knight takes f7, both saves the knight, and gobbles up the black pawn. So that's going to be good for Magnus.
And Gustav has 1 minute and 18 seconds left, and Magnus has 17 minutes.
Yeah, so we can certainly say that this time advantage, we would say that 30 minutes against 30 minutes, Magnus having to play 11 opponents at the same time, you would think this was definitely in Magnus's disfavor. But right now it's looking like Magnus is the one pushing the participants on time.
Very interesting, great rivalry. Both players that we saw today, Fabiano.
So if we go on to the next board, I think we can look at Isaac Wiebe, who. He was having this endgame, which was a bad endgame. He was a pawn down. But it really looked like he could make Magnus use a lot of time, spend a lot of time thinking about his moves. And it has been a success in terms of this is the board in which Magnus has the least amount of time. But the bad thing is that this is also the board. Magnus still has 12 minutes left,
and Isaac is deteriorated. Yeah,
Isaac is down to 5. So even if this is the board in which Magnus is in the most trouble, as far as time is concerned, he's still a massive. He has a massive advantage on time, and also now this move of Magnus is really tricky. Very good move. The knight gives a check, and no matter where the black king goes, Magnus knows he gets a fork on the very next move. So here we see the knight forking the black king and the black bishop. And that's going to be a big success, picking up that bishop, still having an extra pawn. This is big trouble for Isaac.
Now we're down to our final 4 games.
So we're down to 4 games, and Magnus really in control over most of them.
One of our early favorites.
And now Gustav Gudbjørnsen, the Norwegian, has resigned his game. He was a piece down, and he thought, let's not think too much about this. The world champion is going to win. Actually, he may have.
He ran on time. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because in the U.S. they teach you to play until you've absolutely lost, no matter what. Drives grandmasters crazy when they have three queens against you in a simul, but nonetheless, you help your teammates.
Yeah, but that's precisely it. I mean,
right.
In order to get a point off the world champion, you really have to have the participants work together as a team. You need to get him never to get an easy game. Always try to drag it out as long as you can. Make him spend energy walking, but also make him maybe a bit frustrated, kind of thinking, oh, why isn't this guy resigning? I mean, I have a fantastic position, but just stay in there and fight it out.
Michael dropped a piece on board 8. If the board is right, he just dropped a piece.
So the last move was that Black lost his knight on e5, and Magnus mercilessly captured that knight at the first possibility.
Sorry. You were in so deep calculation. I feel like you must have been wistful for a few moves ago. I apologize. All right, so you guys already shook hands with me after this game over. Nice to meet you.
So Michael has resigned this game. Losing that knight just eliminated all his chances, and we're down to
three games.
And Magnus looks really relaxed now. He just
but he has such a massive advantage on time, so he really has nothing to be stressed about, and his positions are fantastic as well.
Our final player who gets the notoriety in any final was being the man to last the very end, down a knight and a pawn.
Who's going to be the last man standing?
We do know the last man standing. It's Isaac Wiebe. He is a knight and a pawn down, but he is the last man standing in this simul against Magnus Carlsen.
Well done by the world champion.
Yeah, it's been a just crushing display. He never gave any player really any chances. So a good walkthrough, quite literally speaking, before the World Chess Championship.
Walk in the park?
But he's getting used to the New York region, you know. He has to acclimate himself. He's going to be here for a while starting November 11th. We're so excited to have the World Championship here in the New York area.
Has to get used to winning here.
Absolutely. So he continues his winning streak into Crimea, and we'll be good.
So after the games are finished, Magnus will actually be analyzing every single game he played with the participants themselves.
But does he remember all the games and everything that happened in the game?
Well, that is part of the question, right? I think he will. Magnus's memory is quite decent, if I could say so myself.
Even in games where the opponents are doing random things. I mean, that always interests me.
Yeah.
I'm sure he can remember his games against you and vice versa, but when he's playing somebody that...
No, but I mean, these are the games he's playing right now.
Sure.
He has it fresh in his mind, and I think it sticks for him.
That's great.
I think maybe a game like this last one he could struggle with because there are so many moves. But right now we have Magnus moving quickly and giving checkmate on the board. A very nice checkmate with the king, rook, and knight combining beautifully to give a backhand checkmate.
But you look like you think Magnus is going to remember all these games in 1 or 2 or 3 weeks?
I mean, even though he remembers them now, I don't think he's sort of going to remember them.
Oh, okay, wonderful. So we have Vedic Panda, everyone. Let's give our players a quick introduction. From the United States, Jed Sloan, Magnus can meet. Jed.
I'll just start down.
We can go ahead. Jed to the left on board number 2. Isaac from Canada. Isaac Wiebe. At board number four, Polina Carolina, representing the Bahamas. Soren Merks from Germany. And as you guys will all notice on the high screens, Magnus, as is customary in Simuls, and many grandmasters will do this, they will try to alternate their opening moves so as to, you know, not, I guess, replicate strategies so close in proximity so that players can not take advantage.
We're minutes away from starting. Which one is the most challenging player, Ludwig? Do you know that?
Well, actually, we can see that Magnus has made his first move on actually plenty of boards right now. It's the last one of the 11 boards. We are set to go. And the strongest player, according to the ratings, is Mr. Gustav Gulbansen from Norway. So it will be interesting to see his game.
He's a 52-year-old from Norway?
Yeah, and he's sitting on board number six. But I think the important part to take in the beginning, there's going to be a lot of moves, quick moves, and I want to stress what Magnus was saying at the very beginning in his interview here with Jonathan. And that is that he's just going to try to play very fast. And it's important for him to get not only a good start, but a quick start. He needs to make sure he doesn't start lagging behind on time on every single board.
Is a quick start better than a good start?
No. I mean, there's a balance. You want to get the games done as soon as possible. But these are good players, so it's not going to be that easy. You might as well just try to play fast and get the game progressing, get as many moves in as little time as you.
And how quickly does he size up which games he particularly has to concentrate on and worry about?
I really don't know. I think the opening will decide that. So after we have a couple of moves on the board, he will probably make some mental note of this is going to be a tricky game. I'll have to spend some extra seconds here, but that's all he has, some extra seconds.
Right.
And then the other boards, he's just going to try to finish it as fast as possible. I noticed that Jonathan was asking Magnus, do you aim to simplify as soon as possible? And that could be a good strategy in terms of it being easier to find the good moves, but it could also lead to a longer game. And a longer game means more time spent.
I also assume, particularly against the stronger players, but against all of them, that he's going to vary from sort of the received best move in that position so he doesn't have opponents that have just, you know, booked up on a major line.
Yeah, but for instance here, we see him moving, actually, I think, quite slowly. He's moving calmly and...
Right.
I don't know, 30 minutes? It's not that much time. So it's going to be very interesting to see how the time situation is in 15 minutes.
Does he have to speed up now?
No, probably not at this moment, but he's very relaxed. I'm not sure that the time could be an issue for sure.
Okay, let's have a look at some of the tables. Does it have a difficult way to...
We can start out with table 6, which is the highest rated player, Gustav Gudbansen from Norway.
Yeah.
And we can see that Magnus is playing against a French defense, and he's trying just to get his pieces out in good positions. Yeah, it's way too early to say anything definitive, but it does seem like in this game, Magnus will have a position that's easy to play.
That exists and people have seen before, this particular position.
Yeah, for sure, but that's not really what matters.
Of course.
I mean, what matters is that Magnus will know what to do the second he gets to the board. So in terms of where... The players, if they can get Magnus to use time, that would be fantastic. Not only for themselves, but also for the other players. So if we can try to see if there's some tricky position here, I would maybe go to board number one and the player Vedic Panda from the USA. And I think this is more of a position that could be tricky for Magnus to find some good moves.
When Chris and Fabiana were playing in the...
So now every single time Magnus is walking around, he's doing his moves pretty quickly. But as long as his clock is running on 5, 6, 7 different boards at the same time, that's going to make the challenge for him. It's actually, it's bad if the players make their moves immediately after he makes his, because then he can just stay there and blitz the moves and get the game finished sooner. But it's also not good if Magnus is spending time on other boards.
And now we got a situation like that. He was moving when Magnus was turning his back.
Yeah, and that is, to be frank, the clever strategy.
Move as soon as he leaves your board. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, not when he leaves, but maybe when he's
turning around.
Right.
Two boards away, then it's going to be a long walk back for Magnus, and you can maybe pressure him on time.
Yeah. And the player on the right side is maximizing his time now, I think.
So let's take a look at game one again with Panda. And it's a really interesting pawn lounge with this g5 move, really trying to complicate matters. And I think that's an interesting strategy, really trying to play an orthodox chess and thereby making Magnus have to think about his moves more.
So I think there's a couple other boards where we have fairly strong players, like expert category players on boards 3 and 8.
Yeah, so we can look at board 3, which is Isaac Wiebe. And this is a Dutch defense in which Magnus has gotten all his pieces out. So it's an unusual, slightly unusual opening, but Magnus just will try to find some way of getting this extra pawn he has on b3, trying to get that to get a new queen. That will be his objective. But I really think that Isaac can do a good job here of making Magnus use time trying to convert that extra pawn.
How would you describe the control Magnus had on this stuff?
I think Magnus has just, it just feels like he's been in complete control the whole time. It's difficult to say what...
Now there's a fork on board one. He's forked the queen and rook.
Yeah, so let's move to board one. A fork on the queen and on the rook, but you can give a check in order to save the queen. Moving the queen to c5 will save the black rook, but it will not save the black knight, which is attacked on the f-file with the white rook. So I think let's go to Michael Dimitriadis on board 8 and see how he's doing with his very unorthodox, I have to say, position against the world champion. He just played b4, and really what has happened, which I'm not a big fan of, is that this rook on c5, it's now on a square that cannot be attacked by any black pawns. And that's also always a fantastic place to get one of your pieces. Whenever your opponent cannot push you away with a pawn, it means your positioning there is reasonably safe. And this rook, which was, it was awkward, it was a bit unusual earlier, it has now really found a fantastic placement to create pressure against the black position.
Pretty happy with how you played?
I was expecting to be the first player beaten by Magnus Carlsen. I was expecting to lose like on move 17, to be honest. I so didn't expect this.
You know, a real fighter here, a real fighter, Jed.
Fantastic, 8-year-old.
That was our substitute 8-year-old who had to resign against the world champion. But it's an experience for a lifetime.
Yeah.
Aren't you going to be able to do a post-mortem, as I said? Magnus, with his eidetic memory, needs no paper or book or even computer to go back over every single one of these games and each variation. I, in speaking with Magnus, have realized that...
Yeah, we haven't actually caught all the results, so let's maybe do a wrap-up on that. Magnus has already won 3 games, is that correct? Or is he up more than that?
The players who played the game. So, obviously, his own games that he just played 2 minutes ago would be like child's play for him, so... You guys will be able to see something very, very...
So Mark is really in control here on basically every single board.
Ben, how are you feeling about
for an average guy, it seems like brain magic. This is incredible.
Yeah, nothing to be nervous about. Magnus is extremely...
so let's see, which game is... You did a fantastic which opponent is now giving him any trouble at all, let's see.
Yeah, I'm still gonna put I'm still gonna highlight Dimitriadis. I think his position has deteriorated the last couple of moves, but he does have the same amount of pawns. It's equal material, and at this moment, that's a success in itself.
Sure.
One player we haven't talked about is Søren Marks on board 5. And this is actually quite a complicated position as far as I could tell. But now it seems that the complications are not working out in Søren's favor. He's also very, very low on time. He only has 2 minutes left. There's no additional time for either Magnus nor the participants.
And then the computer doesn't leave him a chance.
No, because right now Magnus is about to capture this bishop on e7, and that's going to be a piece down, as well as a big time disadvantage. That's not going to work out very well against the world chess champion.
6 board left for Magnus Carlsen.
A fast player, which I believe Soren is not going to pay him homage in that
So we still have material even on board 8, even though Magnus's rook has that great square.
Yeah, no, this is just playing against an opponent which has such a magnificently placed piece. It's really, really irritating because you'd think, okay, I need to get this piece away in one way or another. But it's just so difficult to force him back. You don't have any pawns who can push him back. And when you don't have that, how do you get it away? So right now...
The e-pawn is attacked.
Yeah, right now the pawn on e4 is under attack. So presumably the right move is using your pawn so that they defend themselves... on e4, f5, and g6. But after that, how do you get the white rook, this rook on c5, how do you exchange it up? How do you push it off the board? Because right now, it's just such a nuisance. You really need to get that exchanged off as soon as possible.
Does Magnus get tired when he do things like this?
I would think so. I can say from my own experience that I may not be as fit as Magnus, because every time I do a simul like this, I actually get a bit of back pain. pain after just walking around all the time. And
a
leaning,
headache?
Leaning over the tables.
Okay.
No, not a headache.
Okay.
So yeah, I mean, it's going to be a bit of a physical challenge. I was very surprised how calm he was in the beginning, how reasonably slow yet. And as any fourth grader will tell you, at least as every scholastic chess player will tell you.
As every chess host will tell you.
Precisely. That is not good. So Magnus is aiming that he advances his, if we can take up the board, we can see that Magnus plans to keep a central majority. His pawns are very well poised in the middle of the board. And then he says, I can delay castling as long as I will do it later on.
And Black will have to move his knight any moment
Let's
not a
try
pin
to get
there.
That board on the screen. Because now we see that Magnus was late castling, but he just did it. So his king is safe and he can count on an opening advantage. If we can get the board up on screen.
If any of you are familiar with that position, just imagine that one for everybody.
Let's look for Ben's board. Here it is.
Yeah, so Magnus got his king into safety a bit late, but when you are the world champion, you can you are allowed to make some exceptions to the early castling rule of thumb. Let's see if there are any other interesting positions. Maybe we will once again move back to Michael Dimitriadis. Because here we have Magnus really going caveman style, pushing up his h-pawn, getting that file open for the rook, which is now really threatening towards the black king.
I think he must have visited Washington Square Park and some of the places here in the New York area where caveman style goes on all the boards.
Yeah,
sometimes it works.
Yeah, no, aggressive. It's an aggressive attitude. And I'm not sure it's going to work out here. I think it's been very... Michael has been very good in keeping calm. It's not clear how Magnus can get his queen over from the queen side, the left-hand side of the board, to the king side. So if we can have that board, if we can have the board up on screen, we can see that White's queen really cannot get over to the king side, attacking the black king without... without being exchanged off. So the immediate idea would be to go with the queen all the way over eight squares across, but then it would be exchanged off by the black queen. So for the moment, I think Michael can be happy with his position.
Very good.
And we also have another decided game, and that is... The Yvette was brutally attacked by this duo, the white queen and knight, and we see there's really nothing she could do from the position we had the last time, and the knight and queen just cooperated brilliantly
made on
to
the
give
board,
checkmate.
Yeah.
There was really nothing she could do to prevent this plan from Magnus.
So which opponent now do you think is doing the best? Not in terms of time, but the actual position.
I'm going to have to say the game we were just looking at. I think, although it looks dangerous with this open file, I think Michael Dimitrias has the best position.
I think the queens are off now.
Yeah, so Magnus decided... Let's go back and watch that game again. Magnus did decide to go with his queen, but his attack is now averted with the queens being exchanged off. So we've been talking a lot about time and that time is the best way that these players can pressure Magnus. And if we look at the board in which Magnus has the least amount of time now, it's still on board one with Vedic Panda. So that is good. But the problem is that his king is in a vulnerable position. Magnus really has an attack going with the queen pointing towards the black king, and now also the white rook pointing down the file. So I think this looks dangerous for him.
And as were my worst fears.
Yeah. No, I think
so. In that in game one, what do you think Black should try to do?
I think Black is just in huge trouble.
Can you bring the Queen's Rook to help with? Yeah,
yeah,
he did actually,
precisely but. What he did. Very good. The Rook is trying to force the White Queen off its beautiful central square, and what Magnus is going to do is he's just going to move his pawn two squares up, in order to block this attack, keep the queen centrally placed, and keep Black thinking, what am I going to do with my king? What am I going to do with this white queen attacking my king?
What do you think Magnus is going to do against Pondo now?
I thought he was
going to... queen. Interesting.
Yeah.
I thought he might have interposed. Yeah.
I really thought he would go in between with his pawn. We can see that instead he's aiming just to try to take out the black pawn on b5. Both strategies are probably good. And just look at the two black pieces in the corner. They are really not contributing in the game. And that's going to be... Well, trapped is a bit strong, but they are not contributing. And that means that their value is not as good as what we usually think a rook is worth. It's just, yeah, well, trapped maybe in the corner. Doesn't get out.
Okay, he's chasing the queen to giving up his...
He's chasing the queen, but then he's losing a pawn and he's still behind in development. So
absolutely.
I think Magnus has a very good position here. One player we have not been talking about is Polina Kahelina on board 4. And she has an interesting pawn structure. This is called the Benoni structure. And it looked to me like a decent version for Black until I realized there's a pawn missing. Black is actually a pawn down. Normally you have an F pawn to try to break up White's control over the center. But right now, Black is in trouble. Because the white pawns beautifully aligned in this row, protecting each other, are just forming a very solid solid structure, really full control over the middle of the board, and that's going to force Polina on the defensive. So, yeah, maybe let's move to Gustav Gudbrandsen, the 2200-rated player, who is the highest-rated player in the field. But that is not necessarily going to help you when playing the world champion. So what has happened is that this isolated pawn, this pawn that is difficult to protect because you cannot have pawns guarding it, he actually just lost that pawn. Magnus's last move, queen takes d5, got rid of that pawn, trying to exchange off more pieces, going into an endgame, and just being a pawn up in an endgame. I actually played Magnus once and lost in an endgame, and somebody commented to me, "Oh, Magnus, he's so good at endgames, aren't he? Isn't he?" And I just responded, "Well, I mean, it's just that he keeps being a pawn up in all these endgames."
Then they're easy to play.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah. I mean, it's much easier to win endgames when you're a pawn up all the time. But of course, the reason he's pawn up is that he's played a good strategic game. So Gudbrandsen is trying to do a counterattack, pushing down towards the pawn on f2. We should talk a bit about the graphics we have on screen. because this is a computer analysis of the chances right now. And as we can see, the computer is heavily favoring Magnus on every single board. And the game in which the computer thinks Magnus's opponents have the best chances is board 8 and board 11. So I think let's move to board 11, which is Ben Berkowitz. And I cannot
the computer understand. Might think that, but that kind of looks kind of nasty with those pawns shoved down your throat. I would not.
Yeah, this looks not too good for black, partially because of the white pawns, but also white is just a piece up.
That too.
So this is not looking good for Ben, and I think he's in huge trouble. So let's move to Michael, which I still think he has by far the best position of all the players. Magnus's rook is very awkwardly placed on c4. He will try to justify it. He will try to say, okay, it's unusual to have a rook placed like this, but I can make it work. I have the bishop pointing down the diagonal from g2 towards the black queen side. And he will also try to move his rook into the open file here on b1 and point down the file. So that is going to be Magnus's plan. Michael will do his very best to defend. And he could really use some help from the other participants. Try to get them to occupy Magnus's time. Get them to get Magnus thinking. And then we might be able to see him pulling off an upset here.
So our substitute player, Jed Sloan, on board 2, he turns out to have just turned 8 years old. I checked on that. And how is he doing?
Yeah, let's look at our 8-year-old substitute. He's been doing okay, but at the moment it's the white pawns that are looking just menacing. They are really... It's perfect whenever pawns are protecting themselves, getting a row like this with every single pawn protecting
each other. And down two pawns also.
Pawns. The white king is going to come up. I think it's going to be a victory for the world champion. But he might survive for a long time. The best he could do right now is try to hang on for as long as he can to help the other participants. Right now, there's a scary threat of the knight going to f6, forking the king and the rook. So he will have to try to do something about that in the near future. Let's actually move to Gustav Gudbrandsen, the Norwegian on board 6. And he managed to get his pawn back, but at a cost. Because right now, Magnus is threatening the black bishop. And that bishop really has a limited amount of squares to go to, because it's doing a very important job of protecting the black knight deep inside white's territory. And basically what's going to happen is that black is losing a piece. His knight went into danger and tried to say that, okay, I can get my pawn back, let's try to get that and then escape back out. But what Magnus has done, he has calculated the variations accurately, and he managed to force the black bishop away from the defense of the black knight, and that's going to win him a piece.
Right, it can be taken on any square that it goes to try to defend the knight.
Yeah, so if the bishop keeps staying on this diagonal, for instance, going back, it's just going to be taken by the white knight, and then the knight on f2 is going to be lost.
Do you think Magnus is going to make all the boards? Going to win all the boards?
It's certainly looking like that. I think the only player who's putting up a fantastic fight is Michael Dimitriadis. And I think he's really just saying to the other players, keep on trying, keep on, never resign.
Because
make
I need
him
the
keep
time.
Thinking.
Now he has a time disadvantage, which is not so great to have against the world champion to be 8 minutes down on the clock.
Yeah. So his advantage is that right now there are many other players that Magnus has to think about as well.
Right.
But if it goes down to a situation in which he's one on one against Magnus with less time, that's going to be tricky.
Last year I played Magnus. He played three players at once. He was blindfolded. It was clocked, and I did fine until it was down to the two of us, and then he quickly disposed of me. So you want to avoid that.
So one player we haven't talked about is Isaac Wiebe on board three. And he is relatively equal on material. He's a pawn down. But the real difference here is how good Magnus's knight is. This knight on e4 is just a monster, controlling every side of the board. And he's looking like Magnus, slowly but surely, his pieces in a good position. So I would say the main thing here is still looking at the time. We want to see which player who can pressure Magnus the most on the clock, which makes it a good idea to look at the board in which Magnus has the least amount of time right now. And actually, that is the game with Vedic Panda. I mean, we've been talking about this game for a little bit, but the strategy of the American player has been pretty good. He has lost a pawn, but he has an orthodox position, and he has made Magnus think.
And he's only 15 years old, born in 2001.
Nice. So on board 8 is another expert player where Magnus has advanced his h-pawn.
Yeah.
So that's an interesting game.
So if we look at the board 8, we see Magnus really aggressively trying to bring his rook into play. Normally you do this by castling, getting the rook into the center. And instead here, Magnus sees the opportunity that the black king has castled. My rook is on the same line or adjacent to the black king. Let's try just to open up next to the black king, get that white rook into play without ever having to move it, just pushing that pawn and getting rid of the pawn, basically, to start an attack.
As we all know, two pieces of boards do that. King doesn't want to get castled relatively early.
There are also some games in which Magnus really has tremendous control already. So we might want to mention that as well. We can look at the Norwegian, other Norwegian, Emil Hartvedt, in which Magnus has won a piece. So that's a very bad start for Emil, but it's also a very bad start for the other competitors, because every time Magnus gets a board out of play, the chances of the other players drop. So what Emil can do now, for the best of the whole group, really, is just try to survive for as long as possible, keep having Magnus having to spend time on making moves there, having some vague chances of winning on time. That's going to be an important strategy. We can also mention that there's something. We have one board which just doesn't have any moves. And I'm wondering, what board is that? Is that a relay error? Or are we actually lacking one player?
On board 10.
It's Andrew, isn't it?
No, but I mean, I count 11 players down on the down there. So probably it's just a relay error, which is good, simply because 11 and 10 players, it really makes a huge difference. And the play, they just need to do as well as they can for as long as they can in order to keep Magnus occupied with making moves everywhere.
So on actually on board 2, we had a substitute player, a gentleman, very young man, as you can see, Jed Sloan, who was filling in for Moshe on board 2, also from the United States.
Okay. How old is he?
That's a good question. I think 6 or 7, but I'm not sure.
Okay.
And we see Magnus is really turning the screws on Emil. He's in huge trouble, and he's now about to lose his queen to knight takes e7 check. So I think Magnus is about to wrap up his first game, and that's a big success, and it's really going to make it so much more difficult for the rest of the participants. But
and
Emil
said to us that he tried to don't get a fool on himself in just a few minutes.
Yeah, so I think let's do a little wrap-up of the boards in which Magnus has the least time. And so there's one board that is just Magnus has 20 minutes left on the clock, and the second the board in which Magnus has the second least time is 22 minutes. So we really have to commend Vedic Panda on board one once again, because he's really getting Magnus to think, and it's clear that his creative style has given Magnus some initial problems. However, looking at the position, we can see that Magnus has given back a pawn in order to get some good exchanges. And we can see that the black bishop, the bishop on light squares, is in big, big trouble because it's being blocked by the black pawns. So Magnus has traded the pawn he was up, and he has traded in for a positional advantage instead. Yeah,
I think we saw Emil and Magnus shook hands now.
Yeah, I believe Magnus has won his first game of this simul against Emil Hartvedt.
He should have hung on a bit just to try to make Magnus move at his board.
Well, as we can see if we take up the board,
he's not going to be able to hang on that much longer because he mated.
Emil had lost his queen, so that was unfortunate. But he really should have played on, because even if Magnus is completely winning, you really just need to try to get him to spend those 2 extra seconds at the board, because the 2 extra seconds multiply with the other participants.
Sure.
So let's see if there are any other interesting boards. I think we should go to board number 9. Which is the Spanish girl, Yvette Salada Samara, and in which Magnus has played a very aggressive knight check, forking the king and queen. That is solved by her move, taking out Magnus's knight. But this has opened up for the white queen to go into an attacking position, taking black's knight on h6, and then I think it's a massive attack for Magnus.
That looks like it will all be over very quickly.
Yeah, it looks like Magnus is going to checkmate with a nice sacrifice and then decisive attack. The queen and Magnus's knight combining brilliantly to try to give checkmate there.
But where does Magnus struggling?
That is the problem. We really cannot see any board in which Magnus is in trouble. It really looks like he's got this completely under control. Maybe let's try to go to board 11 and Ben Berkowitz. Because here we can see that at the very least the pieces, the material is equal. And also Magnus has not castled his king yet.